Alcohol harm touches every part of society, from rising hospital admissions and deaths to pressure on families, communities, and the NHS. One of the boldest policies to take it on is minimum unit pricing, or MUP. But what is it? Who does it affect? And does it really work? In this film, we break down the facts, drawing on years of research, expert voices, and real-world experience from Scotland and Wales. We explain how MUP works, what it's achieved, and if introduced in England, how it could be improved. Decades of international research shows that when alcohol gets more expensive, people drink less and harm goes down. Governments have tried to tackle cheap, strong alcohol for years, but encountered a problem. Most price measures affect all alcohol, cheap and expensive, weak and strong alike. Minimum unit pricing is different. It targets only the cheapest, strongest drinks, the products doing the most harm. It sets a floor price per unit of alcohol, so no alcoholic drink can be sold for less than that minimum. It builds off minimum pricing policies that were introduced in the 90s and 2000s in Canada, Russia, and parts of Eastern Europe, although these were minimum prices attached to the volume of liquid, not the unit of alcohol. MUP itself was first introduced in Armenia in 2016, Scotland and Australia's Northern Territory in 2018, Wales in 2020, and the Republic of Ireland in 2022. It aims to tackle very cheap, strong alcohol, which causes disproportionate harm across many communities, particularly our most deprived communities. In Scotland, the minimum price is 65 pence per unit. That means a pint of 3.5% beer must cost at least £1.30, a 12% bottle of wine at least £5.85, and a 700ml bottle of 40% spirits at least £18.20. Cheap products are hit hardest, like strong white cider in Scotland or cask wine in Australia. In England, a 2.5 litre bottle of 7.5% cider still sells for £5.25, which is 28 pence per unit. In Scotland, it must cost at least £12.22. The policy does not affect more expensive alcohol. For instance, a £10 bottle of wine would not be affected at all. Since it doesn't target more expensive alcohol, it doesn't have any impact on alcohol sold in pubs, bars, and restaurants, as these are almost always sold well above the minimum unit price. A £5 pint of 4% beer in a pub is already selling at £2.20 per unit.
And the reason, sort of the theory behind this, is that we know that heavier drinkers tend to drink cheaper alcohol, and so this means that the policy is targeted at heavier drinkers, whereas more moderate drinkers who tend to drink more expensive alcohol are not affected.
When Scotland introduced MUP in 2018, it included a sunset clause, meaning the policy would automatically end unless Parliament chose to continue it. This meant that attached to it was one of the most robust evaluations of any alcohol policy in the world.
So the Scottish Government commissioned Public Health Scotland to do a wide-ranging evaluation of minimum unit pricing. And this led to 19 separate projects, some commissioned by Public Health Scotland and some by independent organisations. And within those 19 projects were 53 different studies conducted. So we have a really wide range of different evidence available to look at the impact of a policy. And across all those studies, they used the best available data, the best available methods to try and work out what impact the policy had. So we have a lot of confidence from that research that we know really what the impact of minimum pricing was in Scotland.
So what did the final evaluation find?
The evaluation of minimum pricing in Scotland found that sales of alcohol decreased by about 3.5% after the introduction of the policy. And that was mainly due to reductions in sales of cider, beer and spirits. We saw much less impact on wine. We also saw that heavier drinkers reduced their consumption more than lighter drinkers, although there was some uncertainty about how far up the consumption scale that went. So we weren't as clear about whether people with alcohol dependence reduced their consumption, but it is clear that heavier drinkers in general did so. And all of this led to reductions in alcohol-specific deaths. So these are deaths caused directly by alcohol, such as deaths from alcohol-related liver disease. We saw those deaths decline by about 13.5%, compared to what we would have seen if a policy hadn't been in place. Evidence on hospital admissions was a bit less clear. There were some signs of reductions, but it was uncertain. And the other key finding was that the reductions in deaths that we did see were concentrated in the most deprived groups in Scotland. So as well as reducing the harm caused by alcohol, it looks like minimum pricing also reduced health inequalities.
The evaluation estimated that 156 alcohol-specific deaths were avoided each year. It is likely that more deaths were avoided from alcohol-related conditions, such as alcohol-related cancers and heart disease, but this is much more difficult to assess. Other predicted harms didn't materialise. No significant cross-border shopping, no rise in illegal alcohol, no shift to other drugs, and no job losses in the alcohol sector. In fact, retailers made more money. Consumption dropped, but prices rose, so revenue went up. And smaller retailers found the policy beneficial, as it levelled the playing field with supermarkets, who could no longer undercut them on the prices of cheap alcohol bought in huge bulk. For pubs, the effects may also have been positive. MUP narrows the gap between supermarket and pub prices. That's why groups like the Scottish Licensed Trade Association and Green King have supported it. And the general public is also supportive of the policy.
Public opinion polling has consistently shown strong support for minimum unit pricing, with far more people wanting to see its introduction than those opposed. Furthermore, polling data shows extremely high levels of concern about the burden that alcohol places on our NHS and public services, with the vast majority of the UK public wanting to see greater government action on alcohol harm.
Trade bodies like the Scotch Whisky Association and Wine and Spirit Trade Association fought MUP for many years, delaying it in Scotland for nearly 6 years, a delay that almost certainly cost lives. But it wasn't necessarily about losing money from MUP. In fact, producers stood to gain from higher prices. What they really feared was the precedent, government stepping in to control alcohol pricing. It wasn't this policy, it was the next one they were worried about. As researchers in Canada have pointed out, industry groups opposed pricing rules in public, but backed them in private when it suited them. So what happened in Wales? Wales introduced MUP in 2020, just 3 weeks before the first COVID lockdown. That timing made it difficult to isolate its impact from the effects of the pandemic and cost of living crisis. Still, results were promising. Retailers complied, strong ciders disappeared, alcohol purchases declined. There was no shift to other drugs or illegal alcohol, and no increase in crime. But unlike Scotland, the Welsh evaluation was much smaller and didn't include robust data on alcohol-specific deaths. That's why much of the evidence base still relies on Scotland. One source of confusion. Although deaths fell in Scotland in the first year of the policy, when the pandemic hit, alcohol deaths rose in both Scotland and Wales. So how can we say that the policy saved lives? Because policy impact is always judged against a counterfactual, what would have happened without the policy. MUP didn't stop the rise in deaths during the pandemic, a rise seen in many other Western countries, but it softened the blow. From 2018 to 2023, the rate of alcohol-specific deaths rose by 34% across the UK. In England, the rate rose by 40% and by 63% in the North East. Just over the border in Scotland, by contrast, the increase was just 9%, showing the mitigating effect MUP had. In both Scotland and Wales, a minority of dependent drinkers reported increased financial strain after MUP was introduced. Some said that they skipped meals or bills to afford alcohol. That's deeply concerning, but it doesn't mean the policy should be scrapped. Dependent drinkers are a small proportion of the population of heavy drinkers, with most heavy drinkers not being dependent on alcohol.
This population of dependent drinkers engaging with treatment are not, they're a long way from being the totality of harmful drinkers. They're in a minority relative to the number of people who are drinking very heavily who aren't dependent, and it's really important to make that distinction between that group that we would have expected to reduce their consumption by the most and the dependent drinkers, who are kind of quite a different group with sort of different needs, right? For whom minimum pricing was never going to be the sort of the silver bullet, and instead they need, you know, well-resourced alcohol treatment services and, you know, integrated healthcare systems and, you know, all these other more complicated things.
People working in alcohol treatment services have stated that many of these dependent drinkers were already forgoing food and bill payments well before MUP was introduced. As the Welsh MUP evaluators stated, the solution to alcohol-dependent people going without food is not cheaper alcohol, but improved access to food.
The other important thing to say is we saw a big reduction in deaths from alcohol-related liver disease after a policy came in, and that could only have happened if people with alcohol dependence reduced their alcohol consumption. So there is some separate evidence of benefits from a policy for that group.
There is a similar debate around whether MUP unfairly targets people on low incomes. The answer is more complex than it seems. Low-income groups are actually less likely to drink, but those who do drink heavily suffer far greater harm than wealthier drinkers.
So minimum pricing does target that group, and it's important that it does so. That's where the harm is. But it only targets the people on low incomes who actually drink heavily. Lighter drinkers on low incomes actually buy very little of the cheap alcohol that's affected by minimum pricing, so they're actually really not affected very much by the policy at all. The other thing to say here is that if you want to improve the well-being, the health, the financial situation of people on low incomes, alcohol policy isn't necessarily your best tool. It helps to improve public health and reduce harms from alcohol, but it's not necessarily the best way of making people better off. If we want to tackle the problems of people in low-income situations generally, making alcohol cheaper isn't necessarily the best way to go about it. Instead, we should be looking at things like welfare policies, housing policies, improving public transport, employment, and so on.
Simply put, if you want a policy that reduces alcohol harm, particularly inequalities in alcohol harm, you have to target the heavy drinking of low-income groups. But alongside this, there should be other support for these groups. MUP reduces alcohol harm, but it also increases retailer profits. We know this because their revenues increase while their costs fall. People buy less alcohol, but at higher prices, boosting margins. Meanwhile, Treasury revenues fall since less alcohol is sold and taxed. Some argue this is fine, as MUP saves lives and that's the priority. But others warn that the windfall profit could be reinvested in ways that undermine public health, like more alcohol marketing. Instead, the windfall could be used to tackle alcohol harm further, for instance, for treatment or early diagnosis services. The Social Market Foundation estimates that MUP raised off-trade alcohol revenues in Scotland by around £65 million a year, and could generate a £600 million windfall across England and Wales if applied there. The Treasury, meanwhile, could lose up to £300 million in tax revenue. The SMF lays out four options. Raise alcohol duties, a simple but blunt measure. Introduce a retailer levy, which may miss smaller stores. Apply a surcharge via licensing, which could be quite hard to enforce. Or introduce a minimum unit tax alongside MUP.
There are different options for taxing the retailer windfall. We think that the best option is to introduce a minimum unit tax alongside MUP, which is better targeted to cheaper products whose profitability rises most under MUP. This involves duty rates being automatically adjusted to ensure that the total tax paid on any off-trade product never falls below a certain threshold. Since VAT is proportionate to price, more expensive products that are unaffected by MUP would not be liable for higher tax under the minimum unit tax. A minimum unit tax therefore offers the best balance of effective targeting and practicality.
By setting a minimum for the total tax per unit of alcohol, it ensures that products benefiting most from MUP, typically the cheapest drinks, are taxed more without raising prices across the board. Wine, for instance, would barely be affected. Beyond recouping the windfall profits, if England brings in MUP, it has the chance to improve on what's been done elsewhere. So what should it do?
There's three ways that England could improve on the policy that was introduced in Scotland. The first is to ensure that the minimum price is introduced at a high enough level. When Scotland first proposed introducing minimum pricing, it would have affected around two-thirds of the alcohol sold in shops. Because of the delays with the legal case and other reasons, by the time it was introduced, it only affected less than half of products sold. So ensuring that the minimum price is high enough in the first place is important. The second thing England could do is make sure that there's a mechanism built into the legislation for increasing the minimum price each year, or at least at regular intervals. And that makes sure that the policy's effectiveness isn't eroded by inflation over time. As inflation goes up, the proportion of products actually affected by the policy and the degree to which they're affected goes down, and that makes the policy less ineffective. So ensuring that the minimum price is regularly increased is important. And then the last thing is making sure that enough support is in place for people with alcohol dependence. There is evidence that they experience some financial strain as a result of the policy, particularly those people who are on lower incomes as well, and making sure that they have support from alcohol treatment services, that they understand what the policy is, what it's trying to do, and how it will affect them, and then having plans in place to make sure that those most affected receive support both from their treatment providers, but also from wider services as well, to avoid any negative consequences of a policy.
In short, set the right price, keep it up to date, and back it up with support for those who need it most. Minimum unit pricing is a targeted public health policy. It reduces alcohol consumption, saves lives, and helps tackle health inequalities. The evidence from Scotland and Wales is clear. It works. But it's not a standalone solution. To make a real dent in alcohol harm, it must sit within a wider strategy. Raising alcohol taxes in line with or above inflation, restricting alcohol marketing, reducing availability, expanding liver health checks, and improving alcohol treatment services. If England follows Scotland and Wales, it must learn the lessons and go further, because lives are being lost, and we already know how to save them.
For more information on this topic, check out the briefings on our website.